it is a pleasure to welcome you. I want to say a word of thanks to Embrace Change, who has brought us in musically this morning. You all sound great. It's wonderful to have you leading our worship and our time together as a spiritual community. It is a joy to welcome each and every one of you to our celebration this morning. The Beverly Multifaith Coalition is delighted to serve as the host of the celebration of our community in all its multi-faith, multicultural, multi-wonderful beauty. In my tradition, we welcome folks with this saying: whoever you are, wherever you've come from or are going, regardless of where you are on your spiritual journey, you are welcome here. And it is in that spirit that we welcome you this morning. As we gather today, we honor all people with deep respect for how each may identify themselves in terms of race, culture, religion, lifestyle, gender, ability, orientation, politics, wherever you've come from, or that we traditionally separate ourselves from one another. This morning, we gather as one community, delighting in our diversity and in our unity. We gather seeking peace for and among all people and all creation. Welcome. By the way, I should identify myself. I'm Reverend Lisa Stedman. I'm the pastor and transitional minister at Second Congregational Church in North Beverly, as people call it.
Thank you, Lisa. And I'm Greg Carmer. I'm pastor at Church in the Cove. Thanks for being here today. So, you know, you might know that religion, that word religion, has its root in the Latin phrase religare. And that means to bind, to tie together. Okay, right on there. Keep it touched on my... It's pulling my whiskers. Okay. Yeah, okay. To bind or to tie together. That's where the word religion, it has its origins. And you probably know yourself that there are ways sometimes in which religion in negative ways can bind folks up internally, keep them freed from expressing the fullness of the good gift of life. Sometimes it binds individuals to ideologies that find expression in ways that harm communities, that tear at the fabric of communities. But within each of our traditions represented here today, and certainly also in humanism, there are threads that stretch towards the transcendent, the things that unite us and bind us together in community, the good, the true, the beautiful, the lovely, the stuff that unites us together as we seek one another, our own welfare, the welfare of our kids, the welfare of our neighbors. So today we have an opportunity to give expression to that kind of artistically. When you came in, you should have received a little ribbon. Thanks to our good friends over at the Garden City Quilters Club, got these little flags of fabric. And I invite you, see where Lisa is standing over there today? She's tying her flag onto that little red cord, kind of a symbol of the things that unite us as we strive together to bind ourselves as one in this time and in this place, sharing common hopes for each other and our neighbors and one another. So I invite you sometime during the service to take your little flag over there. You can wander about at will and tie it on there. Now, throughout the service, we're going to be receiving elements from our different traditions. And one practice in the Christian tradition is to greet each other with peace. Call it passing the peace. And that's one way for Christian communities that we make sure the ties that connect us are clear and open and marked with peace. So I invite you now, even if you need to stand up and move a little bit, to greet your neighbor with shalom, salam, namaste, gassho, however you pass, peace. Greet one another.
Great. Good morning, everyone. My name is Abby Wells. I sing with Embrace Change at Church in the Cove. With me is Jetta, our music director. We're going to lead you in our hymn today, which is O Life That Maketh All Things New, the Truro tune. So you can find the lyrics printed in your yellow bulletin. Johnson for our opening words.
Opening words could just be words spoken toward the beginning of an event, a formal element in a service appearing at the beginning, at the top of a bulletin like this. Opening words could also be words that affect some kind of opening when spoken, like the opening of a cave mouth with the words open sesame, or perhaps the opening of our hearts and our minds and our imaginations, our understandings, or our ways of being. As our very presence here this morning suggests a willingness to undergo the latter sort of opening, let me begin with what for some may be a familiar sounding set of words and then carry them just a little bit further. This morning we acknowledge that the land we are on was for long years inhabited by the Pawtucket people, a branch of the Penacook band of Algonquin First Peoples. Their colonizers named them the Naumkeag, repurposing the name that the Pawtucket themselves gave to their occasional settlement that they had established around the mouth of the Bass River, lands from which they would soon be displaced. The survivors of those early encounters were eventually absorbed into the Massachusetts Tribal Alliance, and through this alliance, their descendants maintain their presence throughout the North Shore today. Looking out at this expanse behind me, I imagine those Pawtucket people being moved by the same sense of beauty and awe and wonder and refreshment and delight that the view provides us today. While a representative from their descendants was not available to join us today, I did receive some suggestions for words that I might share to convey their longings. The words are not those of my tradition, nor is the local Abenaki dialect of the Algonquin tongue my own. That's the language in which these words were originally spoken. But there is something in the spirit of them that resonates with my spirit, and I hope that the same may be true for you this day. O Great Spirit, whose voice we hear in the winds and whose breath gives life to the world, hear us. We come before you, some of your many children. We are small and weak. We need your strength and wisdom. Let us walk in beauty and make our eyes ever behold the red and purple sunset, Make our hands respect the things you have made, our ears sharp to hear your voice. Make us wise so that we may know things that you have taught our people, the lessons you have hidden in every leaf and rock. We seek strength not to be superior to our brother and sister, but to be able to fight our greatest enemy, ourselves. Make us ever ready to come to you with clean hands and straight eyes, so when life fades as a fading sunset, our spirits may come to you without shame. We have spoken, and may it be so.
Thank you. Can you hear me? Thank you, Reverend Dan. Those words were beautiful. And how beautiful, marvelously beautiful it is to be here with all of you together. How beautiful it is to be here with all of you together on this lovely day, celebrating community, and that despite our outward differences, we celebrate our underlying unity in our common humanity, in the aspirations we hold in common to live fully in peace and harmony in our communities that are nurturing, where we are loved, where we are free to love, where we can develop our innate and unique gifts, and to make our unique contributions to this wonderful world of wonder we find ourselves in. And that initial piece of music, that hymn, that beautiful hymn, O life that maketh all things new. You know, as I listened to that last night, I couldn't help thinking that we might easily substitute love for life. For it seems that love is the eternal thread that is common to all faith, and to those with no faith at all. So I'd like to share a few words from Baha'i writings on love. The writings say that God, however we imagine the unimaginable, has created his servants in order that they may love and associate with each other. The cause of creation of this phenomenal world is love. Abdu'l-Baha writes, "Know thou the certainty that love is the secret of God's holy dispensation, the manifestation of the all-merciful, the fountain of spiritual outpourings. Love is heaven's kindly light, the Holy Spirit's eternal breath that vivifieth the human soul. It is the one means that ensureth felicity or happiness in both this world and the next. It is a light that guideth in darkness." And consequently, we are encouraged to cleanse our eyes that we may behold no man as different from ourselves, that we see no strangers, rather see all men as friends. For love and unity come hard when we fix our gaze on otherness. And in this new and wondrous age, we are told that we must be one with every people. For each creature is a sign of God, and it was by the grace of the Lord and his power that they did step into the world. And how appropriate that we're in this beautiful garden. We're told that humanity itself may be likened to the very colored flowers of the garden. There is unity in this diversity. Each flower, each person enhances the other's beauty. And hence the diversity of the human family should be a cause of love and harmony. And as it is in music, where the many different notes blend together in the making of a perfect chord. And as a corollary to this, we are told, do not allow differences of opinion or diversity of thought separate you from your fellow men. or have it be a cause of dispute or hatred or strife in your hearts. Rather, search diligently for truth and make all friends, all men your friends. Every edifice structure is made of many different stones, yet each depends on the other, to such an extent that if one were displaced, the whole building would suffer. So finally, I'd like to offer this prayer for all of us. O Lord, and this is from the Baha'i writings, confirm and aid this assemblage. Confirm these souls through the breath of thy Holy Spirit. Enlighten the eyes by the vision of these radiant lights, and make the ears joyful through the anthems of thy call to service. O God, verily we have gathered here in the fragrance of thy love. We have turned to thy kingdom. We seek naught save thee and desire nothing save thy good pleasure. Let this food be thy manna from heaven, and grant that this assemblage may be a concourse of thy supreme ones. May they be the quickening cause of love to humanity and the source of illumination to the human race. May they be the instruments of thy guidance upon earth. Verily, thou art the powerful, the bestower, the forgiver, and thou art the almighty.
I need it a little lower. Thank you. Good morning, friends. My name is Nancy Coffey. I'm a longtime member of North Shore Friends Meeting, known to most of you as the Quakers. I was asked this morning to read from the Christian tradition. I will do that and then add a little from my own branch. All the world's great religions. Can you all hear me? Almost. Okay. Better? Okay. Okay. All of the world's great religions and the humanist tradition share a foundational precepts of love and compassion. This morning I'll read two short passages from the Christian scripture. In the first, a Pharisee questions Jesus. This is from Matthew 22, 37 through 40. Teacher, which is the great commandment in the law? And he said to him, you shall love the Lord thy God with all thy heart and all thy soul and all thy mind. And this is the great and first commandment. And the second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments depend all the law and the prophets. In the second reading, Jesus speaks to his disciples of the last judgment. When the Son of Man comes in his glory and all the angels with him, then he will sit on his glorious throne. Before him will be gathered all the nations, and he will separate them one from another as a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. And he will place the sheep on his right hand, but the goats on the left. Then the king will say to those at his right hand, come, O blessed of my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me food. I was thirsty, and you gave me drink. I was a stranger, and you welcomed me. I was naked, and you clothed me. I was sick, and you visited me. I was in prison, and you came to me. Then the righteous will answer him, Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you, or thirsty and give you drink? And when did we see you a stranger and welcome you, or naked and clothe you? And when did we see you sick or in prison and visit you? And the king answered them, truly I say to you, as you did it to one of the least of these my brethren,
You did it unto me. My favorite passage from Friends tradition is from the Quaker prophet George Fox, the founder of our movement. And one of his admonitions or advices to fellow friends was, be patterns, be examples. Walk cheerfully over the earth that you may answer to that of God in every person. Thank you.
I'm just moving to challenge my colleague who's trying to film this. It is my pleasure to share a reading from a more contemporary source, while nonetheless wise and inspirational. The poet Amanda Gorman was the first ever designated National Youth Poet Laureate in our country, so designated in 2017. She has been well known in the years since, culminating with her reading of an original poem, The Hill We Climb, at the inauguration of President Joe Biden in 2021. Today's poem, which the author calls a children's anthem, was published as a children's picture book late last year and seeks to remind the newest generation that they have the power to shape the world with their actions and voices. Change Sings by Amanda Gorman. I can hear change humming in its loudest, proudest song. I don't fear change coming, and so I sing along. I scream with the skies of red and blue streamers. I dream with the cries of tried and true dreamers. I'm a chant that rises and rings. There is hope when my change sings. Though some don't understand it, those windmills of mystery, I sing with all the planet and its hills of histories. I hum with 100 hearts, each of us lifting a hand. I use my strength and my smarts, take a knee to make a stand. I'm as bright as the light each day brings. There is love where my change sings. I show others tolerance, though it may take some courage. I don't make a taller fence, but fight to build a better bridge. I talk not only of distance from where and how we came, I also walk our differences to show we are the same. I'm a movement that roars and springs. There's a wave where my change sings. Change sings where? There, inside me, because I'm the change I want to see. As I grow, it grows like seeds. I am just what the world needs. I'm the voice where freedom rings. You're the love your bright heart brings. We are the wave starting to spring, for we are the change we sing. We're what the world is becoming, and we know it won't be long. We hear change strumming. Won't you sing along?
Good morning. How's that? Okay, it's at the right level. So thank you, Nancy. So again, I'm Rabbi Allison Adler, and I'm really pleased to be part of this morning.
from Temple B'nai Abraham up the street. And I want to share that today, in the Jewish calendar, the lunar calendar, is Tisha B'Av, which is a date. It's the ninth Tisha, the ninth of the month of Av. It's like saying the 4th of July, in a way, except it's not as happy a day. It's a day of deep mourning. It's a fast day for many in Jewish tradition. And some of the customs include sitting on the floor at night, at least with candles, and chanting lamentations, which in Hebrew is Echa, which I'm going to do for you in a moment. But first, Dina, what is this day about? It's about the destruction of both temples in Jerusalem. That our tradition teaches that the first temple was destroyed by the Babylonians and the second by the Romans on the same day, ultimately. And then laid on top of that are different calamities in Jewish history that befell our people in different generations. So it's a day of mourning. And, you know, one of the questions is why, something that happened so long ago, why do we have to do these things and remember them? Actually, a lot of Jews don't observe Tisha B'Av, so you know that. And part of it, I want to just read something. It comes from one of the teachings about why we read Lamentations. So the melody to Lamentations, to Echa, is haunting and beautiful and heart-wrenching. And one rabbinic teaching says that the purpose of reciting Lamentations is to arouse one's heart to mourn. To arouse one's heart to mourn. Because I don't know if you're familiar with Lamentations, but it describes incredible violence and destruction and destitution, exile, and it's really horrible. But I think about that. Been thinking about that idea of we sit and do that because so much of our world, so many things that go on, in order to live, we can't feel it all, right? I mean, the news comes on, or we read the news, and it's so much every day. We have to go about our lives. So to have these set times or moments to rouse us to mourning, at least as a community, and I think serves the purpose that mourning then can lead to something else. Right? That's the idea. There's something happening with a whole bunch of rabbis in Boston later about lamenting the problems in our world and what we're going to do about it. So that's part of the idea, because the destruction of the temple as God's house, we also think of the world as God's house. So that the brokenness in the world, the shattering that we're experiencing in so many, I'm not even going to name them, you know what I'm talking about, right? To have moments where we really feel it, and then how can that move us to where we need to be moved, to do what we need to do. So with that, I don't want to necessarily lead all of you to deep mourning this morning, but I'm going to just share so you can hear what the melody sounds like. And this is from Lamentations, or Echa. Yeshvu la'aretz yidmu ziknei vatzion. He'elu afar al rosham hagru sakim. Haridu la'aretz rosham betulot Yerushalayim. My eyes are spent with tears, my heart is in tumult. My being melts away over the ruin of my poor people. As babies and sucklings languish in the squares of the city, they keep asking their mothers, where is bread and wine? As they languish like battle wounded in the squares of the town, as their life runs out in their mother's breast. What can I take as witness or liken to you,
O fair Yerushalayim. And then interestingly, the rabbis later added a line to Lamentations. So we repeat a line that's in there. So as not to end on that sort of thing, it ends on Kadesh Yamenu Kekedim. You know, take us back, God. Let us come back. Make our days new as of old. So returning to a peaceful Jerusalem, or to returning to a peaceful world, but also making it new in the ways that we need to make it new, to change it, right? To really, because we don't want to just go back to something, because it's never been. We've always had problems. We want to make it new and make it heal. And that's something that I think that we all share, along with the love and everything else. So thank you.
Good morning. My name is Gail Cantor. I'm an interfaith minister and the director of Belonging and Spiritual Life at Endicott College, as well as their interfaith chaplain. And speaking of making things new, many of my students come to me looking for spiritual practices that are easy and that they're able to do to refresh and replenish themselves daily. And I often give them these four recommendations that I think are pretty universal to all of our faiths and that sort of cross the boundaries of anyone. They're found in all the faith traditions. The first is to wake up in the morning and have gratitude, and really the practice of gratitude, to actively say, what am I grateful for? I'm grateful to wake up in the morning. It's so easy to be grateful sitting in this beautiful surrounding all together in community. So to pick something, either a person or a place or a thing or a gift or a sense of life that makes you grateful, and appreciate that every morning. And then to practice the practice of contentment during your day. What's that? That's to say, whatever comes my way, I accept that, and I am content with what I have, and with the opportunity to deal with the things that I deal with, even my challenges. And then the third, and this one's an important one that we all could do today while we're here even, but I like to do it at the end of my day, is forgiveness. To be able to forgive ourselves for our own shortcomings during each day, and to forgive others for theirs, to not carry that forward, to let that go and not carry it on and on and on. So if there's something you're holding on to maybe this morning, either about yourself, which is easy to do, or others, which is also easy to do, you could take a moment and just practice forgiveness. And then the last is compassion, and that's recommended for the whole day long. The word compassion comes from the etymology is C-O-M with, and passion for suffering. So it's to be together and to appreciate that we all suffer, that we all are in life, and we're all limited in the ways that we're limited, and therefore we should practice accepting ourselves and others and extending compassion to one another. Albert Einstein had a quote. He said, a human being is part of a whole called by us the universe, a part limited in time and space. He experiences himself, his thoughts, and his feelings as something separated from the rest, a kind of optical delusion of his consciousness. This delusion is a kind of prison for us, restricting us to our personal desires and to affection for a few persons nearest us. Our task must be to free ourselves from this prison by widening our circles of compassion to embrace all living creatures and the whole of nature in its beauty. And I wanted to thank everybody for being here this morning to create this circle of compassion and acceptance and contentment, forgiveness, and gratitude. Thank you.
Yeah. I don't want Lisa to yell at me. Okay, can you hear me? Yay. Okay, I know you can. I'm wondering about you back there. Yay! Good morning, Beverly. My name is Joan, Reverend Joan Amaral. I'm with the Zen Center, and this is Seitetsu, who's also with the Zen Center. So this is a beautiful segue from Gail. Gail, thank you very much for the invitation to invoke gratitude. So gratitude for this tree, first of all. Shade. For this cool grass, if anybody's sitting on the grass, how cool and refreshing it is. These beautiful flowers, this cooling ocean, especially if you don't have air conditioning, like me. How fabulous it is to be able to just walk to the beach and jump in. Gratitude for the organizers of this. Thank you so much. Thank you to my colleagues in the coalition for continuing to do the difficult work of showing up in the midst of difference to forge unity. It's not easy. But as someone else said, the arc is long. So we can be in it for the long haul. Thank you very much for being here. The segue that I'm excited about from Reverend Gail is, Zen, there are many ways to translate Zen. One way is to do. So Zen Buddhism is a religious practice. So I'd like to invite you right now, with the body you have, with the mind that you have, to meditate with me, to practice compassion, forgiveness, gratitude, solidarity, letting go. These are all things that sound so wonderful, and it's so easy to stay on the level of conceptualizing them. It's so easy to practice them. It's actually easy to practice them. The challenge is to sustain that practice in our actual relationships. But right now, all you need, as long as you have a body, is to just use it. So, feeling your feet on the ground, grounding yourself. Feeling the breeze on your face. Feeling the breath in your body because you're alive. Your eyes can be open or closed, whatever feels best for you, to begin to just focus inward, to turn inward. I see this as a kind of homecoming ceremony. We're celebrating homecoming collectively. And this is one way individually through the body to practice this homecoming at home, the home of gratitude, the home of forgiveness, the home of connection, the home where we're safe, where we're loved. So staying right with the breath, feeling Mother Earth beneath you, supporting you, encouraging you, saying, yes, take up this invitation to come home. Take up the invitation to feel home. Breathe in and feel yourself expanding into home. And on the exhale, feel yourself releasing, arriving fully home. Do it again. Breathe in, expand, and breathe out, release, trust. And as you stay with your breath and you stay connected with the Great Mother, you might give rise to a prayer, a wish, an intention, the thought of happiness, the thought through the body, through the breath of peace, the intention, the prayer experienced through the breathing body, of freedom from suffering, well-being, and the intention, the wish, the prayer, the whole body thought of safety. You may say to yourself, may I be happy. Breathing, may I be peaceful. Breathing, may I be safe. Breathing, may I be free from suffering. Grounding yourself in that goodness, filling yourself with that goodness. Now fearlessly offer it to everybody, those sitting next to you, your loved ones, those sitting a little further away in this garden, your loved ones, those who are over there across the park, your loved ones, and those beyond Beverly, in every direction without exception, your loved ones. Please bring forth the wish, the prayer, the intention, the body thought, with your whole being grounded, expanded into love. May all beings everywhere without exception be happy. Breathe it. May all beings everywhere without exception be peaceful. Expand into it. May all beings everywhere without exception be free from suffering right now. And may all beings everywhere without exception be safe. And now let your mind just rest, the mind of trust, the whole body mind of trust, just simply breathing and allowing the echoing of all this goodness within you, knowing it's part of you, it is you. Just taking a moment in silence to just simply enjoy as you feel the breeze, the cool grass, the energy of the human beings next to you. Just rest.
Hello again. Our final two songs we're going to sing today are World of Wonder and Together. The first song we're singing, World of Wonder, we actually sing and dedicate this song to a little girl called Riley Fessenden, who you may have heard of. She was an incredible little girl. Unfortunately, she passed away when she was 9 years old from a very rare form of brain cancer. Her memorial rock actually is right over there. So we dedicate this song to her.
Sorry, there's some challenging conditions for tuning today.
And like before, you can find the words in the bulletin, World of Wonder.
Bended low from the weight I was under. And many is the time I have spent a worried mind while living in a world of wonder.
I have troubled my soul doing things I can't control whilst waiting my next foolish blunder. And though I try to tell myself it's in hands of someone else, while living in a world of wonder.
Up above the darkened cloud, there's a light to be found. High above the lightning, thunder. Oh Lord, hear my plea. Won't you help my eyes to see? I am living in a world of wonder. To the end, and she never let her faith go asunder. And though she lost her worldly due, she could smile and say to you, man, we're living in a world of wonder. Up above the darkened cloud, there's a light to be found. High above the lightning and the thunder. Oh Lord, hear my plea. Won't you help my eyes to see?
I am living in a world of wonder. I am living.
I am living.
You are living.
You are living.
We
living in a world of wonder.
Our last song is called Together, and this came out actually right, I would say in April or May of 2020, so a direct response to the coronavirus, but it's a great message regardless. We love the breeze, but we gotta pin the music down.
This is for the busted heart. This is for the question marks. This is for the outcast soul, lost control, no one knows. Sing it for the can't go back. Sing it for the broken past. Sing it for the just found out, life is now upside down.
If you're looking for hope tonight, raise your hand. If you're feeling alone and don't understand. If you're fighting in the fight of your life, then stand. We're gonna make it through this hand in hand. And if we fall, we will fall together. Together.
This is for the second chance. This is for the new romance. Sing it for the loved in vain. Overcame, it's not too late.
If you're looking for hope tonight, raise your hand. If you're feeling alone and don't understand. If you're fighting in the fight of your life, then stand. We're gonna make it through this hand in hand. And if we fall, we will fall together. Together. When we rise, we will rise together. Together.
If you're looking for hope tonight, if you're feeling alone tonight, if you're looking for love tonight, we're gonna make it happen, then I will be by your side. Love is in the air tonight. Come up and see the light. We're never, ever, ever, just as long as we're together singing.
We fall, we will fall together. Together. And when we rise, we will rise together. Together.
If we fall,
and if we fall, we will fall together. Together. And when we rise, we will rise together. Together.
Together we are dangerous. Together with our differences. Together we are bolder.
Braver.
Stronger.
Thank you to our musicians from Church in the Cove. Thank you very much for leading us in worship this morning. Thank you for all who participated this morning as well, for coming together in such a shared spirit of hope, really, a hope expressed in our very coming together this morning. Operating in hope this morning, we are also deploying some people with some baskets who will be holding them out as you leave this Rose Garden. And the offering that we are gathering this morning will go to Family Promise of the North Shore that is working to end homelessness throughout Beverly and all across the North Shore. So if you are able to give, if you feel free to give, if you feel led to give, please know that it's going to a very important cause. May the feet that carried you here carry you away with the sure steps that come from knowing that you do not walk alone, that others are walking beside you. May the hands that you extended in fellowship this morning retain the memory of those who were willing to grasp them in common recognition and common cause. May the hearts that drew you here be encouraged that they are joined in lamentation for a world that is broken, and be emboldened to join with others in building the world that we together long to live in. a welcoming place, rich in colors and cultures, a hope-filled place, rife with opportunities for rich and poor alike to know and experience growth and learning and thriving. A place where a just peace may be realized for all people and for all time. May it be so. Go in the blessing of that hope.